The Edenic covenant is, and that, how would you describe the Edenic covenant? What would you say?
Covenant.
Or Eden. It's Eden, what do you mean by Eden?
Paradise.
Okay, yes, and what else?
Adam.
But what made it paradise for them?
They had everything.
They had everything.
Yeah, that they needed or wanted.
It was not only good for food, but pleasant to the side, they beautiful and children. Okay? That's all very well, and that's all true. By the way, I hope you know, typically, I never want just one response. That's unheard of. So, okay, there are people living right now who have everything they want, not just what they need, everything they want. They have beauty, they have comfort, they have pleasure, and they're not in need. What makes Eden? All that's true.
God is there.
And
but God is here.
That's right. But what's the difference?
They're not with God.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We have an Eve there, sin here.
And they always walk with God, as opposed to I often don't want it. I'm not making sense. In other words, there was a constant presence of God. What else? This is good. It's about time we were doing this. What makes it evil? Not just beautiful, pleasant, or that. God, yes. That's a big, huge difference, if I could put it like that.
Well, it was food, and you didn't have to labor for it.
Okay, but neither did the very, very, very wealthy.
They were immortal?
They were what?
They were immortal, but what is so good about immortality?
They were like God.
They were like God.
There was no death.
No death, but they weren't immortal. But immortality alone, unless there's something to go with it, is not something to be sought. Okay, I'll tell you where I'm coming from. I'll give you a specific example. In Greek tradition, there was one who could ask of the gods for anything he wanted. One request. It could be have things that were with it. Do you follow me? It wasn't necessarily a simple request, but so he asked for immortality and what beauty and what you, okay? What he forgot to ask for was eternal youth. So when you see a breast out there, that's that way. He followed. He got older and older and older and more shriveled and shriveled and shrunk. So immortality without health, without youth, all that is not to be desired. In fact, I'll tell you, I'm reminded of what my neighbor Evelyn said, after her husband was, had Alzheimer's and had not put him out of the ditch, she finally could no longer live at home. And then for the fifth time, she had cancer. And he said, hey. And one morning, she was still able to come and ask one morning, I said, how are you? We called her Mama Evelyn because we've been so close over the years. She said, getting old as hell. She was in pain. She was not looking forward to anything except more pain and grief. You follow me? You see why I say eternity or immortality is not necessarily a blessing. How many older people I have? I know a number of older people who say, what does it like to? I remember one lady in Jewel, when her daughter left her one morning and said, well, Mom, I'll see you this afternoon. She says, oh, I hope not. Am I making sense? What then makes it? You say, okay, God, and certainly all, not minimizing all the beauty and pleasure, everything they've given, but I'm just saying, on earth, there are people who have a lot of that, but they're definitely not in heaven, definitely not in heaven, definitely not in evil. So what else makes it? The relationship with God. Being like God. What do you mean when you say like God?
You remain in His image.
That's right. And what does that mean?
Pardon?
Actually, we were looking at there was nothing else to see on television the other night, so we were watching a rerun of the Archie Bunker, what's the name? All in the Family.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the first time that he had had any association with a black guy. And the black family that moved in next door. And when the guy came home, they were talking about Archie Bunker said, well, it's nice that you people are being treated better. Since you're definitely inferior, we're glad to share some things with you. And I says, inferior? And Archie Bunker says, well, I'm made in God's image. You're not. Unfortunately, he's not the only one who said that. But, okay, what clearly doesn't mean physical language. What does it mean?
Without sin.
Pardon?
Without sin.
Okay, without sin. So notice, no guilty conscience. Nothing. Notice they were naked and unashamed. What does that tell you?
No guilt. No guilt.
No sense of having to cover up for anything.
So that brings up the question of the apple. You know, did Eve really know it was wrong or what was going on?
Good question. Okay. In Christian tradition, in Catholic tradition, the understanding is indeed she spoke the truth when she said the serpent tripped her.
I often wondered whether she really thought she was doing wrong. I don't think she did. But she was tricked.
Interesting that how often do we do wrong things simply because we don't think?
Without realizing.
Simply because we don't think. We just We just do what we do. And, oh my goodness, hurt people's feelings. Say something, something pops out of our mouths and we say, and we say that. Again, I'm reminded of Eddie when her husband was yanking out handfuls of hair and knocked over a stool and on and on and on. He was urinating in the corner of the room. And she said, and I was taking communion to her because she couldn't move it. And one day she says, oh my, thing, Father needs to come. Things come out of my mouth that I didn't know I'd ever thought.
What was Eden part of heaven?
Is it part of?
Was it like, well, I heard there was different levels of heaven, of like a seventh heaven, and different layers of angels were higher up, or like, was Eden like part of heaven, or one of the...
Okay, one of the things that's important in this sense is to remember that heaven is not a place. What I'm getting at is, okay, where is God? If he's everywhere, then everywhere is potentially heaven. And so it's not a place that makes heaven. John Milton, Paradise Lost, and he's right on target with what he said in this regard. He is not in every respect, but when he has Satan come and look at Adam and Eve in Eden, he says, oh hell, what do my wandering eyes behold? I said, the best use of profanity in the English language. In other words, Eden was hell to him. All right, again, another character, another play, and this is a play, not a poem, but a play. It's a contemporary of Shakespeare, Marlowe wrote it. And so he's talking with this guy, he's giving his soul to the devil. And it happens to be the devil talking to him, though the guy doesn't know that. And so the devil is very honest with him. He says, you know, I am Beelzebub, I am the devil. And Dr. Faust is the guy, says, oh, you can't be, you're not in hell. And the devil said, myself in hell, why am I out of it? Okay, so what is Eden here?
Little older.
What makes Eden? Eden. Notice the relationship with God, being like God, but we're still like God. We're still making an image of God, right? But, as you said, without sin, no guilt, no shame, nothing to be ashamed of.
The devil took a rebelled against God and took a third of the angels with him. And then Adam and Eve took the sin. Now, somewhere I... Maybe it was in Revelation or something. There's a new heaven, and he's made.
There will be a new heaven.
So will the new heaven be foolproof, where no angel, no person that goes to heaven could ever rebel? I mean, will it be like?
Well, it's not. It's not a matter of can't. It's a matter of won't.
Well, then something has to be perfected, like. Whatever it is to rebel would be non-existent.
Okay.
Right?
You've said something that I want to pick up on. It's very new heaven and the new earth, right? Remember what happened here. A kind of a starting over, a new earth. Okay, so that's not the first time you get that, you see. In other words, new heaven and new, and by the way, new heaven and new earth, new heaven, in that sense, by the way, is new sky, not new capital heaven. In other words, a new, well, if it's going to be like this, then it will be, heaven will be truly on earth. Now let me go back to where's God. We said that one of the differences between us and them, they walked with God all the time, we off and on. Okay, is God with us?
Yes.
Then if to some extent we're not in heaven, then we're not in heaven.
I think heaven is here.
Okay, and that's the teaching of the church.
So when the devil is put in a pit, that eliminates all possibility that of being tempted.
No.
No?
No.
No?
No. As, again, do you remember Pogo? The college strip Pogo?
Yes.
In one of them, he says, I have found evil. And it's myself.
Yes.
So it doesn't take the devil sometimes in that extreme, the ultimate evil, for us to do, to stand. Yes.
So then Eden and heaven are a mindset.
Yes.
Michael Morwood writes, I love Michael Morwood, and he writes about believing it that God is near and not believing in an elsewhere God. There is no elsewhere God. God is here, God is near, and heaven and hell is right here, hell we made it.
Okay, Jesus, what did Jesus say? The kingdom of heaven is where?
Here.
He even said within you.
Yes, that's pretty close.
Okay, now, okay, what was the relationship of Adam and Eve to each other?
She was a part of him.
They were one. What was the relationship of Adam and Eve to all that was around them? And the relationship of all that was around them today?
They were over them.
They were over them, true.
Mm-hmm.
Good. What else?
Well, they were equal. They were talking to the, like, it was like, everybody was like the lamb and the lion were next to each other, and everybody was in harmony, the animals, and so.
Okay. In fact, the prophet Isaiah picks up on that and says that will happen on God's holy mountain. That's Isaiah. Yes, okay, notice, everything was for something else or somebody. Okay, what was the garden for them? God gave them everything that was good for food, and the eye to the eyes. And what were they to do? With the garden.
Use it more.
Till and keep it. Notice, God and man, humankind, God and humankind bring fruitfulness, which feeds them. So notice, everything was for something else. Everything had a purpose. Even humankind, especially humankind. So notice, absolute harmony. The Catechism calls it the original justice. Everything got what it deserved. Because it deserved good. Do you follow? of the original righteousness. Now, that's the reason it isn't just beauty and love and ease and comfort and pleasure that we seek. Because we know very well you can have all of that and still be in hell. Right? The poor rich kid. Poor kid too. I mean, you understand what I mean? So notice, it's because of all that we've just been talking about that we long for Eden. Is this making sense?
Can you have materialistic things and still have no guilt?
I have no idea. I'm serious, and I have no idea. You know why I have to say that? I cannot know somebody else's conscience. I cannot know somebody else's heart. Okay, questions?
So heaven is kind of like a state of being. And if we get to a certain level of God, we're there. And we die. But now I'm hearing that you could still be tempted to do something bad if you're in heaven, or no?
No.
Once you're there, you're okay.
You're there.
Yeah. Okay.
You have. There is no temptation because what could tempt you? Or what could you want that you didn't have? Okay, I'm going to give you St. Thomas Aquinas' definition of heaven. Would you say he's Orthodox? Would you say he's a good Catholic? I think we could, right? Okay, heaven is a state of mind, a state of being, a direction, and where God is. Notice, a typical Catholic response is, which of these is it? Yes. Okay, now think about it. As a person thinks within his or her inmost being, state of mind, that's what he or she is. As a person thinks within his or her inmost being, state of mind, that's what he or she is.
But you got to be in harmony with God. Or, I mean, your state of mind in your mind could be perfect, but it's somebody else.
We're not talking about my perception. We're talking about absolute, right? So, what you think, that's irrelevant. That's like saying, in my mind, this is not murder. I killed him, but it's not murder.
That's wrong, and that would be bad thinking.
Sure.
Yeah.
You know, you could say, oh, maybe I should put it like this. In my mind, I didn't kill him. That way, there's no, okay, even if it's not... Even if it's not murder, even if it's not outright murder, you know, that's culpability. If I kill somebody, I can't say, well, I don't think I killed him. Can I? He's still dead, and I did it.
If you tell a lie enough, eventually he'll believe it.
But you see, that's the reason I said it doesn't depend on my thinking, or yours, or yours, or yours. Because, yeah, we can lie to ourselves. As Father, the one who wrote the Our Father, Father Beck. Father Beck said on one occasion, somebody said, are you absolutely sure you'll go to heaven when you die? He stood there a moment and he said, I am capable of deceiving myself. I know that. So am I going to say, I'm going straight to heaven? He said, I think that would be presumptuous. In God's mercy, in God's forgiveness, I will see him face to face. But I'm not going to say, got it made. I'm not going to say that. I know I can deceive myself too much. So notice, this is not talking about what I think or what you think. You see what I mean? This is absolute. State of mind, state of being. Okay, why direction? Because we're on our way, or not. You could say, tell me within your inmost self you think what you are, and I'll tell you the direction of your life. Okay, and where God is. But you said God is everywhere. Right? It's the reason I said if to some extent we're not in heaven already, we may never be. Okay, what is that?
I got a question.
Yes.
Just say, like, we're all sinners.
Yep.
And say you die and you're in a state of sin, but then is there such a, like purgatory will get you in, like, there's like, it's like a purification, a final purification. Does everybody go through purgatory? Because if everybody's sinners, I mean, unless you're like the Virgin Mary, I mean, it's
okay.
You almost like purgatory. Everybody's gonna get a little taste of it. Is that wrong thinking or?
No. Let me give you a couple of things. One is Chaucer. The wife of Bath has had 5 husbands, and she thinks her 5th husband was unfaithful to her. So her response is, by God on earth, I was his purgatory. You got it. Okay.
So that would, like, heaven is here now to some extent.
Okay.
So is purgatory.
Life is purgatory. Aren't we supposed to be letting God purify us right now?
Yes.
Okay. Now, many of you remember Rosie Grant.
Oh, yeah.
Rosie, a dear, dear person. She said to me one time, oh, John, I am so grateful to God for purgatory. I said, what? She said, I'm so grateful to the dear Lord for purgatory. You know, I know myself well enough to know I haven't let go of all the things I ought to let go, and I'm not going to be able to before I die. I'm glad he's going to finish the job. I think that's pretty good theology. Do you follow? So, yeah. Now, let's look. Okay, give you his definition of heaven. What's St. Thomas' definition of hell?
Same thing.
State of mind, state of being, direction, and where God is not. By the way, Pope John Paul, this was several years before he got really, you know, so that he was not doing well. He wrote an article, an encyclical or something, and in it he said, we must all be aware that heaven, hell, and purgatory are not places. They are states. The state of mind, state of being, they're states. Pope John Paul himself said that. And really, that's been the understanding since pre-Christian times. Okay, I hope I'm not taking too much time with this.
No.
So when in this state you're living, like it says, like when he said, I'm the God of the living, so somehow, whatever we'll be living in a state of something.
He said, I'm the God of the living and the dead.
And the dead. That's right.
John, what was the covenant then? The promise that God made in Eden?
That they would have everything and everything would be in harmony. It's an implicit promise. That's the reason I said the word covenant is not used in regard to Eden. And yet,
It was there.
Yeah. It was. Good question, Jim. Good question. Yes. And notice, it was an implicit agreement to continue you, humankind, Adam, Eve, people, okay, continue to walk with me is implicit. I do not eat of this fruit. But today is a warning. It's a command. It's a warning. The day you eat of it, you will die. You will become mortal, subject to death. So, all of this is an implicit covenant rather than stating it directly. Am I responding?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So why did he give them that? If it was supposed to be such a wonderful place, why he was testing them? Or why did they even have that warning? Don't do this.
Good question. Okay. If, let me back up, then I'll come back. The church says that innocence is not virtue. Innocence made no choice. Robert Burns has a poem, The Uncouth Deed. That's the rigidly righteous. And in that poem, he says, you lady who condemned this beautiful young prostitute, maybe you were never a temptation. Do you follow me?
What did you say?
Maybe you were never a temptation to any man.
Oh.
You see? And so, notice. Did you walk in her shoes? Is another way to say it. Right? Okay. And so the church has always taught that innocence, that is lack of temptation, is not virtue. And there has to be the possibility for sin for us to choose God. If we have no choice, we're not people. And we're not virtuous people. Okay, there are unfortunately, Char has a grandchild who's now, that child must be going on 2. And that child cannot even lift his head, her head. She was a little girl. In other words, she is a newborn infant, totally innocent. Right? We would never say, oh, look what virtue. Look what goodness. Am I making sense?
Mm-hmm.
So, good question, John. Without choice, we're not who we are, people. Any other question or comment? Okay, now. We did make our choice. We did disobey. We can think of it in all sorts of ways. Now, what's the consequence? For the serpent, you'll bite the dust. And her offspring, her seed, literally, will bruise your head. What about for man, the man?
That's 12.
Now that tilling is going to be toil. And it's going to be unproductive because by the sweat of your brow, you'll earn your bread. But what's going to happen? What will come up? What will?
Weeds and thistles.
Yeah, thorns and thistles. Exactly. So notice, hit the guy where he is. He's the one who does that kind of work, right? So it's going to be tough from now on. For the woman?
She's going to labor in pain.
Pain in childbirth and labor. And her husband will rule over her desire. And I've told you, I think, for centuries, until probably the 20th century, it was understood that a woman's sexual capacity was greater than a man's. And so, notice, that promise is a consequence, right? That covenant, again, Jim, it's implicit. There's no statement there that it's a covenant. Question?
Okay.
Noah. Notice things went from bad to worse to absolutely the pit. Every imagination of the thoughts of their heart was only evil continually. But there was one righteous man, Noah. And so, in effect, God, in a sense, made a new heaven and a new earth. Does that make sense? And, okay. That was me. Hi, Carolyn. We're reviewing.
Oh.
And so, Noah is, again, God wanting to have a relationship with all humankind. Noah and his family, right? And notice God starts with a couple and now goes to a family. Okay, any question? Notice that didn't work either. So now, God does not make a new heaven and a new earth. Oh, what's the covenant with Noah? I almost forgot. What's the covenant with Noah?
The rainbow.
The rainbow. And this specific statement is, I make my covenant with you. And notice, what is a rainbow? A bow is a weapon, and God turns it into a symbol for peace. And that's the covenant. I will never again destroy the earth by water. And I think I mentioned to you, 1 Peter says, God saved 8 people through water. By the way, you know that the church has traditionally been called the Ark. Do you know that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay, now things went down again, and so God chooses again a righteous man. And this time, what is the Abrahamic covenant?
That he blesses all people, all nations.
You will be the means to bless all nations. I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will, notice, I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. And through you, all the nations of the earth will bless themselves. Kevin, I was thinking about that in relation to your question about the killing of all those people. Notice, why would God curse those who cursed Abraham?
In cursing Abraham, they were cursing him?
They were, yes, cursing his plan for humanity. So, notice, God, and we saw this right away. If God didn't protect Abraham, he's down the tube already. Remember what he do right off the bat? Tells a lie about his wife. She gets taken into a harem. Remember this?
Yeah.
If God didn't protect him, whatever would happen to him? Is Abraham perfect? Absolutely not. Does righteous mean perfect?
No.
No way. Remember, is the Pope a sinner?
Mm-hmm.
Are the saints sinners?
Yes.
We must never forget that. Okay, so Abraham is not by any means perfect. Okay, question. All right, now. Remember Abraham's son Isaac, not his son Ishmael, not his other four sons. Isaac is the
firstborn.
Is taken as the firstborn, though he's not, and is to represent Abraham in the next generation. So he, through him, all the nations will bless themselves. Not Esau, but Jacob. Isaac's son Jacob is, in effect, the firstborn. Remember, Esau sold his birthright, as the text says, thus he despised his birthright. And so Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, through him, all the nations will bless themselves. Now then, we have the 12. Okay, remember. You remember what Reuben, the oldest, the firstborn, did?
Didn't he lay with his father's wife?
Yeah. So, that pretty well ruled him out. Okay. Then we see Judah gaining in stature, Joseph. And so as time goes on, it's Israelites. Is it not? Through them, all the nations will bless themselves. Okay, they're in Egypt. You remember?
Mm-hmm.
All right. What then does God say? Tell Pharaoh, Israel is my
firstborn.
Israel is my son. And who is he talking about?
The whole nation.
All of these people. Israel is my son, my firstborn. Let my son go that he may worship me, or I will kill your firstborn. Okay. Then we saw this working out. And okay, then the Mosaic Covenant. God tells Moses to tell the people, out of all the people on the earth, though the earth is mine, you will be my special people. You will be my treasured possession. And you will be a... You will be what?
A blessing.
True, but how is it stated? chapter 19 of Exodus, 6, 19, 6, you will be for me a kingdom of
priests,
a
holy people,
holy nation. Ah, notice, a priest is a mediator, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now notice how now the Israelites are to be a blessing. They're to be a holy people, a priest to the rest of the world. Okay, this now we're getting to the Mosaic Covenant, right? And notice, okay, what is that holy nation to be like? Well, God says, be holy for I am holy. Be like me. And then he gives them what?
The Ten Commandments.
Ten Commandments. Plus. Okay, here are ways you can become like me. Now, okay, questions. Notice what a rough journey this has been. Do you follow me? This has not been something, when we complain about the cold or something like that, I'm talking about us in here, complain about aches and pains and whatever. Think about what all of the patriarchs and matriarchs endured. The people who have carried God's message to the rest of the world. It was not easy. And they were not perfect. So we can't make the excuse, I'm not good enough. Right? All right, and any question or comment before we go to the material today? I hope I haven't taken too much time in this.
Why did God create us in the first place?
Out of love. Love wants to share its love. By definition, if we love, we want someone. Notice. How many couples do you know who cannot have children who express their love in maternal and paternal ways? Adoption, but other ways too.
Didn't something like God said something, I knew you before you were born.
Before you were born.
So we existed a long time ago, so we're...
This is Jeremiah, by the way, the prophet Jeremiah.
So that's way out thinking. In other words, we were running around with God since the time before we were born.
Interesting. St. Augustine plays with that idea that we are with God and then born, in that sense. But what God is saying is God lives in no time. So before you were born, I knew you. God has always, no, not has, God always knows us.
So we did exist?
No, is that possible? Perhaps. But that's not the teaching of the church.
But like when Peter said something, he says, you don't think like God. In other words, his intellect is so unable to, like human can't understand God's intellect.
Absolutely. How could the finite comprehend the infinite?
So, like if I said that we actually existed and were in God's presence before we were born in this form, that can't be too far from the truth then.
In a sense, if you recognize that with God there is no time, you could say, in one sense, given that, heaven already is, and those of us who In heaven or in heaven, and I'm not talking about in time, obviously.
You know, I'm thinking that when you say exist, exist means to us in a certain time and space here. Mm,
that's right.
But so that's why we couldn't have existed in that way with God.
Yeah, we were existing in God's mind then.
There.
Yeah.
Okay. Exactly.
Okay.
Well said. Good. Did I respond to your question?
Yes.
Okay.
So we did exist in one sense, and I mean, something I can't explain, but in other words, we existed in God's thought.
In God's mind. And
he made us what we are.
In one sense, you could say what was, is, and will be with God. Nothing changes.
Well, someday we'll know.
Yeah.
Is that predestination then?
No.
It's what's called predestination,
no,
yes.
I think that's different than what we think of predestination.
If I agree. If we think of predestination as God controls something, destines us, and that, yeah, no.
No.
But predestination is really foreknowledge. Yeah. Okay. Any other question? As I say, I think it's about time we did some of this. And if you like, we'll do it again sometime. Just to sort of keep us on track. Because we're not just learning, quote, facts, unquote. If that's all we're doing, we're all wasting our time. I'm reminded of the father of one lady who said, my dad is plotting how far it is from one place to another throughout the whole Bible. And I said, why? She said, good question. Okay. Now, we left the people in chapter 33. We were in chapter 33. We're going to come back and begin there. For today, of Exodus. Exodus chapter 32. Now, do you know how the people were led out of Egypt, by what means? And there's more than one answer to this. How were the people of Israel led out of Egypt, by what means?
Well, that cloud, wasn't it?
Okay. A pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire and Moses and
God.
Okay, God in the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. But you know what the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire are called? Of course, pillar of cloud and pillar of fire, but what else? They call God's angel. What's an angel?
A messenger.
A messenger. They call God's angel. And they're also called God. Do you see why?
Because God is present in that.
Because God is present. So, did they think the cloud was God? Heavens, no. Deliberate, bad pun. Okay, have you noticed how important clouds are in Jewish and Christian tradition? Cloud and fire? How did Jesus ascend?
In a cloud.
How will they come again?
In a cloud.
How did the Holy Spirit come?
Burning bush.
Tongues of fire.
Burning bush and tongues of fire. Notice, Old Testament, New Testament. And I could go on and on. But see, do you see the kind of thing I'm talking about? Certainly they didn't think that bush was God, and they didn't think the tongues were God. Okay. So now the people are coming out, and I'm in 33, let's see, Jude, can I pick on you today? chapter 33, verse 2.
Driving out the Canaanites, the Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, I will send an angel before you to the land flowing with milk and honey.
Okay, notice. I will send an angel before you. Okay, and verse 8.
Whenever Moses went out to the tent.
Excuse me, do you know what tent this was?
The ark was.
Is that where the ark was?
Tabernacle, the place where the Ark of the Covenant was. And do you know what the ark looked like?
Like a chest.
It was a chest or a box,
yeah.
Chest. And do you know what it was covered with?
Gold.
Gold. You know what was on top of it?
Cherubim.
Cherubim and a seat. And whose seat was that?
God's
seat. God's seat. So now that's the Ark of the Covenant. Do you know what was in the ark?
What was?
What was inside the ark? What was placed in
the
ark?
The
Ten Commandments. What else?
The staff of Moses.
Staff of Aaron when the Levites rebelled against Moses and Aaron. And said, we're just as good as you are. God said, let all of you come out and place your staff before you. And Aaron's staff budded. So he was chosen. Okay, so Aaron's rod. What else? A jar of manna. A jar of manna. Okay. Julie 8.
Whenever Moses went out to the tent, the people would all rise and stand at the entrance of their own tents, watching Moses until he entered the tent. As Moses entered the tent, the column of cloud would come down and stand at its entrance while the Lord spoke with Moses.
Okay, notice the kind of thing. I haven't been having you read that, but I thought just this good reminder of that. Skip to verse 15.
Moses replied, if you are not going yourself, do not make us go up from here. For how can it be known that we, your people, and I have found favor with you, except by your going with us? Then we, your people, and I will be singled out from every other people on the earth.
Okay, notice. But for what? For what? For what purpose?
Well, to be a witness,
To be, a blessing. Yeah. To be a priest.
Yeah.
Okay. Chapter 34. Now remember when Moses came down from the mountain, he found the people in revelry and so on with a golden calf, a golden bull. And by the way, you know what the gold calf, to call it a golden calf was to minimize it. Golden bull, you know what the golden bull was in Egypt?
An idol.
It was a god. Yeah, it was a god. So notice, they rejected God to go back to worshiping an Egyptian god. Okay, and you remember the killing we talked about and the Levites doing that. Okay, now, chapter 34, verse 1. Julie?
The Lord said to Moses, cut two stone tablets like the former, that I may write on them the commandments which were on the former tablets that you broke.
Notice, broken covenant, broken tablets. All right, and then verse 6.
Thus the Lord passed before him and cried out, the Lord, a merciful and gracious God.
Excuse me. Notice that's Yahweh. Remember, don't ever forget that Lord substitutes for the divine name. Okay, start again, would you, Julie?
Thus the Lord passed before him and cried out, the Lord, a merciful and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in kindness and fidelity, continuing his kindness for 1,000 generations, and forgiving wickedness and crime and sin, yet not declaring the guilty guiltless, but punishing children and grandchildren to the 3rd and 4th generation of their father's wickedness.
Okay, this quotation, it's a poem, really. This poem you will find repeated in Numbers, in Nehemiah, in Psalm 103, in Jeremiah. I mean, this becomes the characterization of the Hebrew God, God of the Israelites. And notice who first expressed it? God himself did this, recorded here. Okay, yes.
In reading those, it says that he forgiving wickedness, crime, and sin. Then it goes on to say that he will punish the guilty, including to the 2nd and 3rd generation. Now, why does he punish the 2nd and 3rd generation that had nothing to do with the original?
Good question. First of all, I'm going to tell you something else that's in the Bible along with this. In this period, and for some time to come, if the head of a household murdered somebody, say, or committed some crime worthy of death, do you know who died with him?
His own family.
His family and?
Servants.
Servants and?
Livestock.
Pardon?
Livestock.
Everything that had any connection with a man. Now, there was one way to prevent that. And this occurs during the time of David, but it's not exclusively there, but this is a good example of it, I think. David protected the servants and the livestock property of a man named Nabal, N-A-B-A-L. And then he and his men were hungry. This is when before David was king. He's out in the wilderness, you see. And by the way, wilderness means desert. This is not a jungle. This is a stark, dry desert. And so, by the way, you want to know, you might ask, well, what's the livestock eating? I wonder, because you see that in Israel, and you wonder, what can they be eating? But apparently there's a little here and there that they eat. But okay, David asked for some food and water for his men. And Nabal says, get away from here, in effect. So David and his men are going to attack Nabal's camp, if you will, or Nabal's whatever. Nabal's wife comes out with provisions and with servants bringing them and tells David, please don't have blood on your hands. You know that my husband is a fool. And that's what Nabal means, by the way. And so have mercy on your servant. So David does. So notice, women were property of men. Come on. I don't mean that they never have been in any culture, but that is certainly overstated in the Bible. Yeah, some of the laws, but some of those laws continued into the 18th century. And when did women get the right to vote?
1920,
yeah. Late 1920s. Okay, so up till then, were they the property of their husband? No.
No. Did some of the men act like it? Sure, some still do. I think we mustn't wait to, but okay, now to come back. The understanding was, if the head of the household is like this, those within the household would be that way, unless they separate themselves from it. Okay, let me ask you this. What do we say about the children of a Bonnie and Clyde type couple? What chance have they got?
Chip off the old block
and so on. So notice, that was certainly an understanding in the earlier time.
Good.
I would like to call your attention to one thing. Okay, I said that, but notice, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for the thousandth generation, for the giving iniquity and transgression and sin. Okay, at what point could any of that punishment for the guilty be at least ameliorated, made better, if they confess their sin? By the way, you know that somebody whose parents or grandparents were like this, even if they become good, faithful people, they bear the scars. Do you know? Well, don't we all have the scars of our family?
That's why we talk about carrying our baggage.
That's right. I've gotten in touch, well, actually, a distant cousin got in touch with me. Her grandfather and grandmother, her great-grandfather was a bootlegger in Mississippi. The revenueers were about to get caught. It's my grandmother's brother. And he ran away with his first cousin. The two of them married, had 8 kids, and some of those children turned out to be like their father. And this woman's grandfather was found dead on the highway. He was an alcoholic and, you know, whatever. And her father deserted her mother, and she was brought up in an orphanage. Third and fourth generation. I think that when we look at families like that, and this is my family, when we look at this, I think it makes it a little easier to understand. Yeah. Okay, Julie. Chapter 34, verse 10.
Hear then, said the Lord, is the covenant I will make. Before the eyes of all your people, I will work such marvels as have never been wrought in any nation anywhere on earth, so that this people among whom you live may see how awe-inspiring are the deeds which I, the Lord, will do at your side. But you, on your part, must keep the commandments I am giving you today.
You can skip to 12.
Take care, therefore, not to make a covenant with these inhabitants of the land that you are to enter, else they will become a snare among you. Tear down their altars, smash their sacred pillars, and cut down their sacred poles. You shall not worship any other god, for the Lord is the jealous one. A jealous God is he. Do not make a covenant with the inhabitants of that land, else when they render their wanton worship to their gods and sacrifice to them, one of them may invite you, and you may partake of his sacrifice. Neither shall you take their daughters as wives for your sons. Otherwise, when their daughters render their wanton worship to their gods, they will make your sons do the same.
Okay, What does your translation say about instead of wanton worship? Is that what all of you say? Okay. Kathy used a pardon?
Prostitute.
Okay. Notice your Bible is trying to clean up the language. Okay. Do you know what the Bible calls those who reject God? They go a whoring after other gods. Remember what the word in Hebrew that we translate no means?
Intercourse.
Intimate relationship with. So you see why, what else would you say? If they know another god, that's being a prostitute. Do you see what I mean? So, okay. Now, did you hear the word? Covenant?
Yes.
Okay. Now that's what's sometimes called the Palestinian covenant. Yes, it's directly connected with the Mosaic covenant, but notice, this has to do with their going into the land. I don't know why it's called Palestinian. I think I would call it the Promised Land covenant. But questions there? Okay, let's go to Numbers. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. We're going to skip a book. The only thing I'm calling your attention to in the book of Leviticus is the one chapter 19. And, well, maybe we should look at that on the way. Leviticus 19. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. Next book over. Okay, chapter 19, Julie. Start reading verse 1.
The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the whole Israelite community and tell them, be holy, for I, the Lord, your God, am holy."
Notice, but this is, I don't want to die. Keep reading.
Revere him.
Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to turn it off. I'll get it later.
Revere your mother and father, and keep my Sabbaths. I, the Lord, am your God. Do not turn aside to idols, nor make molten gods for yourselves. I, the Lord, am your God.
Did you notice what you got there in amongst these other statements? You shall each revere you, mother and father. Where did you find that? See, notice. Leviticus is, in many ways, a commentary and extension of the Ten Commandments. And there's one more I'd like you to read, verse 18 of that chapter.
Take no revenge and cherish no grudge against your fellow countrymen. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord.
Okay. That sounds familiar? You shall love your neighbor as yourself?
Mm-hmm.
Remember, the people of the New Testament did not have a New Testament. They were the New Testament. And so what were they teaching Jesus? How did they teach Jesus? From the Old Testament. From the Old Testament. From the Hebrew Bible.
So,
yes.
Like even today there's false gods, so it's our task to show these people who are worshiping false gods, just like these people were given the task to don't make covenants with them, but just kind of convert them, I guess?
Interesting, because what did St. Paul say that was very similar to this? Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Remember? Don't marry somebody who's not a believer. That's kind of gone by the way, isn't it? But that was the idea. And
so God is still at work doing what he was doing back here, he's still...
In some ways, the more things change, the more they remain the same.
So it's almost like an insult, like, you know, here I get all this, and you're still like the,
If God were like us, we'd say, I'm just going to destroy the whole mess. Thank God he's not.
Yeah,
you go, oh my goodness, the complaints all the way through the wilderness. You know, why did you bring us out here to kill us in the wilderness? Why didn't you leave us there where we can have meat? And so on. Of course, God did give them meat here. Okay, chapter 1 of Numbers, the next book over. Okay, this is the numbering of all the tribes. And I want you to notice the number that you have. In verse 3, what is the number? Chapter 1, verse 3, what number do you have there?
20 years, right?
Okay, you're to number the men from 20 years and older. Notice you'll see that again in verse 18. You'll see that in verse 20, you'll see that in verse 22, all the way through this chapter. Do you know what 20 was?
What are those magical numbers?
Yes and no. In their tradition, 20 was the age of accountability.
Age of what?
Accountability. Full maturity, so you were responsible. By the way, that continues to be true for centuries in Christianity. Notice in Shakespeare, Romeo and Juliet, how old were they?
They were pretty young.
They were not 20, that's right. So notice, who is reprimanded for what happened to Romeo and Juliet?
Their parents.
Their parents. And so, anybody under 20, and this continues in the 18th century. It's sort of lost in the 19th century. But for centuries, 20 years, until you were 20, you were responsible for your children.
Yes. But what was the life expectancy for getting Abraham and all those? What would have been the life expectancy of somebody at that time?
By the way, verse 30 was the age of full maturity. And 30 through 50 was regarded as the peak of a man's life. That was his, what would I call it? That was the prime years. And I'm sorry. What was the life expectancy? I don't know, but Barzillai, one of David's men, was 85. And the psalmist writes, God promises us 70 years and 80 if we are strong. So, one of the things I think we often think of is average life expectancy. And you have a tremendous number of infant deaths. And so that's one of the things that brings life expectancy down, because we say average. I'm thinking, in fact, just recently, let's see, it was Monday, I think it was St. Anthony's Saints Day. Do you know how old St. Anthony was when he died? Any of you know that? 105. And he died in 356. 105. So, yes, some people live to be quite old.
And how old was Methuselah?
Oh, Lord, I don't know. 800 or 900 years? Yeah. But I don't take that one in the same sense. Okay, now, would you turn with me to chapter 3 of Numbers? You notice all those tribes were numbered, right? The census was taken. Julie, verse 11.
The Lord said to Moses, "It is I who have chosen the Levites from the Israelites in place of every firstborn that opens the womb among the Israelites. The Levites, therefore, are mine, because every firstborn is mine. When I slew all of the firstborn in the land of Egypt, I made all the firstborn in Israel sacred to me, both of man and of beast. They belong to me. I am the Lord."
Okay, now remember, the Israelites are to be a priestly people. Next time, remind me to cut that thing off with you. Remember, the Israelites are to be a priestly, a kingdom of priests, or a priestly kingdom, a holy nation. Okay? God chose the firstborn, consecrated to him, given to him, really. That's what that means. Okay? Now, notice, the Levites ordained themselves, remember? When they were the ones who killed, the ones who rejected God. Now, notice, the Levites, and they are the priests, they aren't numbered. They are to represent whom? What did Julie just read?
The firstborn.
They're to represent the firstborn. So notice, you keep getting these ways, okay, the firstborn is God's. That's to signify that everybody's God's, okay? They're to be priests. So the Levites are to represent the firstborn and represent the rest. It's called centralization, isn't it? You're getting this series of representations. Am I making sense? Okay, all the firstborn, let me repeat, all the firstborn belong to
God.
And how do you show that?
God claimed them.
Pardon?
God claimed them.
God claims them. And how does a parent of a firstborn respond?
Gives them back.
Gives them back by means of a sheep that he sacrifices to God.
Right.
Okay, and of course that firstborn then is replacing the father as the head of the household. Do you follow? Okay, now, and they're to be priestly people, right?
All 12?
All of them, yeah. All of them are to be priestly people. They're all to be priestly people. Okay, now, who represents the firstborn as a priestly people?
The Levites.
The Levites. The priests themselves represent the priestly people.
Could a family dedicate a child to be a Levite, like just say?
No. No, that was hereditary. So
you couldn't marry into the Levite clan?
Nope, you didn't marry. Okay, somebody asked about, I forgot who asked about, what happened if a man had no sons? You remember?
Mm-hmm.
And I told you, they always married within the same clan. And that's the reason scholars say that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was of the priestly clan, because Joseph was. Do you see?
Well, she had to be. Right, because.
Well, she didn't have to be in one sense, but in another sense, yes, because of the...
He would not have chosen her otherwise.
Hard to say, because she was chosen not because she was of the tribe of Judah and the descendant of David, but in another sense, yes, that was, I guess this is what? God's knowledge?
So Jesus was a Levite.
No, she was not a Levite. She was of the tribe of David. And we have, how do you get from the Levite to David? That's to come. That is to come, and that will happen.
But you just said that he wouldn't have married her unless you...
Was that the tribe of
David?
Yeah,
because
that's right. That's right. But, and as I said, I'm going to show you how we get from the Levites to David, because then you've got something different. And notice the Davidic covenant. Okay.
You kind of lost. Can I go back?
Sure.
Joseph was a Levite?
No.
Oh, okay.
Joseph was a descendant of David. And it was assumed, and so would Mary be, because you're always married within your clan. That's the tribe of Judah.
Oh, okay. All right.
Tribe of Judah.
All right. I just thought you said that he was...
Thanks for clarifying that. Any other question? Okay, we've got a minute or two. Chapter 8 of Numbers. Oh, I'm sorry, never mind, because that's a repetition. So we'll go on to chapter 20. Chapter 20 of Numbers. We're skipping a lot, of course, but the focus is on the covenant. Chapter 12. Julie? Chapter 20. Chapter 20. Chapter 20 of Numbers. Got it?
In first one.
Okay, pardon? Start with verse 2.
As the community had no water, they held a council against Moses and Aaron.
Did you notice? They held a council against Moses and Aaron. Go ahead.
The people contended with Moses, exclaiming, "Would that we too had perished with our kinsmen in the Lord's presence."
Oh, here we go again. Notice? Go ahead.
"Why have you brought the Lord's community into this desert where we and our livestock are dying? Why did you lead us out of Egypt only to bring us to this wretched place which has neither grain nor figs nor vines nor pomegranates? Here there is not even water to drink." But Moses...
Okay, now notice. They were just slaves. Why did you bring them out? When they had all these wonderful things to eat and meat and said earlier, remember? Okay, now keep reading.
But Moses and Aaron went away from the assembly to the entrance of the meeting tent, where they fell prostrate.
Okay, now, when the people rebel against Moses and Aaron, how is that understood?
They're rebelling against God.
They're rebelling against God, because remember, Moses and Aaron were God's men.
And they were representing God.
Exactly. The one as the prophet, the other as a priest. Okay? Keep reading, Judah.
Then the glory of the Lord appeared to them, and the Lord said to Moses, "Take the staff and assemble the community, you and your brother Aaron, and in their presence order the rock to yield its waters. From the rock you shall bring forth water for the community and their livestock to drink." So Moses took the staff.
Notice you've heard this before, right? Mm-hmm. I'm actually going to stop because I talk too much. We went about a minute over. I'm going to pick up with that next week and go on then. The next we'll go to Deuteronomy and we'll continue talking about the Palestinian covenant for a bit. And then we'll move on through Joshua, Judges, into 1 Samuel. Shall we pray? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Gracious Father, guide us this day that we may be your priestly people, a people who show by our lives that we have been with Jesus. Guide and keep us, be with all who need our prayers. We pray in the name of the Lord Jesus himself. Amen. Mm-hmm. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. I've always liked St. Francis' statement, "Everywhere you go, preach, and if you have to, use words."